Welcome to the Fripp VT user meeting. As you know, our meetings are to focus on subjects that are of interest to you, our Fripp VT users, to update you with what's going on and to add value to your membership. Many of our users tell us that just attending the Fripp VT user meetings are worth the price of admittance with their monthly membership. Before we introduce you to our special guest, who is my right-hand person in my business, Jim Prost, I'm going to introduce to you Paul, who you know is the Director of Client Experience. If you are one of our newer VT members, if you have any technical problems, you email Paul. If you have any questions about the content, about your presentations, you email me. So Paul will tell you how to answer polls, and we'll bring up the first one, ask questions, and then we're going to take you directly over to Fripp VT because we have some new additions and great content that you might not be aware of. So take it away, Paul.
Thank you, and hello, everyone. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will see a chat box. Within that chat box, you'll be able to ask your short, specific questions throughout the call. In addition to the chat box, there will be a polling question area just below that where you can select your answer to the poll and then click vote. We're going to start with the first poll. Do you feel competent using PowerPoint? Yes, no, or never tried it. Select your answer. You'll have about a minute. Click vote. And please try to make sure to get in your short specific questions sooner rather than later, so we'll make sure to have plenty of time to answer them.
Okay, good, Paul. So if we can head over to Fripp VT. There we are, good. And in the training center, you are going to find that we have two new courses, and understand when you sign in, yours will be straight in the training center. But if you have not seen, we now have two extra courses. We've recorded a third one, which will be added in the very near future. So maximize your executive overview. And the otherwise is maximizing your networking opportunities. You will remember our last user meeting, we interviewed Susan Rowan, who is the best-selling author of How to Work a Room. Now, what you might not be aware of, because it will show up to you as if it's other courses, but we are taking our Fripp VT user meeting, chunking them into 20-minute segments. And as you may know, there are a lot of other webinars that I conduct. I have a sales series. I interview different experts. And so Paul, just show them what the categories are in webinars.
Absolutely. Now, I'm going to have a few extra options because I am an admin within the site, but you'll see Fripp VT and webinars. Once you click on webinars, you'll go to the different sections, and I'll go ahead and turn it back over to you, Ms. Fripp.
All right. Well, why don't we click on, how about sales series, just to see what we've already added here. So you see, build your business and credibility. Andy Paul is a best-selling author, one of my coaching clients. I have changed my process of sales based on one of his books. Kurt Shaver, about how to use LinkedIn to expand sales. Sherry Leventon, New Science of High Impact Sales. Don Hudson, of course, on selling value. And an interview with Troy Harrison on our methodology. These are just the first ones that we have put up. We have more because we are creating content faster than our VT members could actually use it. So I promise, even those of you who've been members for 2.5 years, and we appreciate your constant support, you are never going to run out of content. So let's just show a couple of other the categories and what we've already included, Paul. We have our VT user meetings, and this one will be added to that area in fairly short period of time. We have, for those of you who are professional speakers And we, of course, have lots of expert guests as we do today. So, Paul, let's see what we've already added there. Brian Kaplowitz, 12 ways to get compensate other than cash for your speaking, for sakes and growing your business. Andy Paul again. And Tom Drews is how to deliver captivating visual presentations. So some of the content we'll put in different categories if they apply there. However, you have our personal guarantee. More content is being added all the time. So with that, Paul, if you can come back to our guest, let's see what the poll says. You tell us the result of the poll.
Do you feel confident using PowerPoint? 92% said yes, 8% said no, and then 0% have never tried it.
Okay, so those of you are alive are at least using it, and we're glad that so many of you are comfortable. What we do want to ask them at the end, Paul, is have they learned techniques that they didn't know, especially those who are confident? Now, Jim Prost is one of my Fripp associates. Not only does he build my PowerPoints, although he's taught me how to prepare my information before I give him so he can do it faster, which costs me less money. And I'm sure you're interested in that too. But he also, he helps many of our corporate clients and some of my other VT user members who need more help, obviously get a special rate from Jim Prost. But he was a director of marketing and a vice president of sales for technology when he had a real job. He's been a college professor for 26 years and twice honored as the instructor of the year from UC Berkeley. And that's because he has the ability to make his classes more interesting, captivating, as well as entertaining and educational. He teaches presentation skills and marketing skills at college. He's the co-author of an instructor's book, a manual with David Akers, Strategy for Marketing Management. He was a past president of the local chapter of the National Speakers Association, Northern California. And welcome, Jim.
Thank you, Patricia. I'm very excited to spend this afternoon with you to share my enthusiasm for PowerPoint and hope that you learn one little nugget like I have through the last 20 years of using PowerPoint.
Can you say every day you learn something new? Is there that much to learn?
Mostly I learn is workarounds. When there's a problem, you find a way to work around it. And when we get into the presentation, you will see some of the elements that I've added to my PowerPoint presentation, which is going to be added to yours as well.
Oh, perfect. See, once you discover something, I benefit from it. So I love it. Very often it's a surprise to me when I get it back. Now, Jim, you have been using PowerPoint ever since it was invented, isn't that right?
That's right. And the way I got interested in it, Patricia, was I was walking through campus over at Berkeley one day, and the dean said to me, you know, I can hardly wait until our professors embrace PowerPoint because we're here in Silicon Valley. And I thought to myself, that's when the light bulb went on, and I was the first one to do it. My colleagues weren't too happy because I always got the equipment for the presentations. But ever since then, I've been doing PowerPoint and Keynote. Not so much Prezi, but I do some of that. Mostly I work in PowerPoint. And like I say, every day I learn something new. And I'm going to share some of the new elements that I've just learned this week with our audience.
All right, perfect. Well, while Paul brings up the PowerPoint, you also told me that you are a PowerPoint insider with Microsoft. What does that mean?
What that means is that they send new add-ons to those of us that have signed up for this, and we get to test them and then give Microsoft feedback, and then they decide what they want to add and what they want to subtract. And I'll share that too as we get into the presentation, because there's some elements of PowerPoint that they've removed, and I'm not too happy about that, but we'll talk about that when we get into the presentation.
Okay, and as you see, and we also put in Jim's lower third, which is name, if you need to email him any any particular questions, or if you want to call him. And we do have a resource guide and a handout for this presentation that will come to you as long as you signed up and registered. Remember, you don't always have to be live, but we do encourage you to sign up and maximize your membership. So, okay, let's see what you have, Paul. I am going to shut up Jim and Paul and let you take over.
Okay, so the first series of slides is going to be some of the animation that I've added to the my presentation. And this took a little bit of time, but it did, as you see, it did work pretty well. Next slide, please.
Good. Well, the Fripp VT turning is a new image. And will my name turn around in one of my PowerPoints soon?
Actually, I think I sent you the slide where that does turn around. So yes, we're going to have it. So today's agenda is we're going to talk about where to start. And then I'm going to talk about designing captivating slides, color, which is very important, using photos and video. I'll talk a little bit about that and give you some of the trade secrets that I have used and workarounds for that. Discuss animations and transitions. And it's showtime is basically to talk a little bit about ways that you can use PowerPoint in your, wherever you're presenting to your different advantages, whatever it is you want to, how you want to work, like the presenter's view or just a straight on slide. But we'll get to that in a little bit. But the big, I think, issue today is at the very end, or not the very end, but close to the end, we're going to spend some time. Two of the VT participants submitted slides to us a week ago, and the idea was that I would go through them and make some recommended changes to see if they like them and discuss some of the elements, because that's an easy way to learn in my point of view. So I believe we've asked this. Have we gotten any response to this, Paul?
We have not yet.
Okay.
So we need to ask, what is your biggest challenge with visuals? All right, good. So so in this way, if they respond to the chat room, that's right. You're actually answering your question rather than doing, rather than just doing a poll. Good.
So what we wanted to do is talk about where to start.
Yeah.
And this is not the place to start. This is a picture of a desktop with PowerPoint open, and I don't know how many of you do this, but I didn't use, I used to do the same thing, but I've learned something the hard way by a technique that almost all of the people that teach presentation skills say, and that's to start out with. If we can advance the slide. Thank you. And what we're doing is going from digital to analog. And Patricia and I have worked on this for her presentations as well. And if you can advance the slide, thank you. Patricia, do you want to add anything about storyboarding?
No, I'm going to let you do it.
Okay, perfect. We'll do that then.
Not many women were willing to show their community photos of them without makeup. And when I used that image, it was sometimes you're creative. You know, you're not necessarily sitting down, I have 3 hours to work on my presentation. Sometimes you're in noisy places, you get some creativity and you always want to collect the ideas.
Yeah, I would agree with that as well. So this is an example, if we can advance the slide. This is a clean looking storyboard. If we can go to the next slide. This is not a clean one, and this is the one that I'd like to spend a few minutes with. Is I was teaching a presentation skills class some years ago, and I was working with a colleague, and she said to me, well, you know, Jim, you really should be doing storyboard, because this is the problem with PowerPoint. It's constraining, and it's not opening up like Patricia was talking about. And this proves I'm horrible with graphics, but that's not the point. These are horrible graphics. What I wanted to share with you was what I learned from doing this, and it was very hard, I have to be honest, because my natural tendency was to go to PowerPoint. But what I learned from this was I laid down the framework, the structure, as Fripp would talk about, And then I realized as time went on through the rest of the day, I started adding what was going on. And so there was an interaction going on with our waiter and the manager of the restaurant, and it became a much bigger story. The storyboard became much bigger, and it had gave me a lot of room to embellish the story rather than just the constraint. So my view is PowerPoint's constraining, but our task is to figure out ways around that. This, Fripp, do you want to talk about this slide?
Well yes, because obviously Jim has built PowerPoint for me, well, as long as I've been using PowerPoint. I have no idea how long that is. So I have some images, I have some slides that I'm going to use. So after I do my storyboard, my messy, my flip chart, put it together in, as you're familiar with the Fripp speech structure, this is what I do on a flip chart. Then I put together the slides. Now I pull them together from what I already have, and then I'll send it to Jim and say, hey, can you make this look pretty? Or I might do a note, insert slide here with an image of that says this. So I do as much work as I can ahead of time so I can. So you look here, I have slides that I pull from different decks that have the different, what do we call the template? And so I send what I need to Jim, and then he takes it from there. And all I need to know is, how do I change slides? How do I insert them from different decks? Or to get it ready. And so I save Jim time, which means I save me money.
She costs me money because she's saving the time. The past year, Patricia and I put together in what we're calling a master deck. And pretty much what she does now is she selects the slide she wants for a presentation, sends it to me. I do go through it to make sure everything is working correctly, because I have found when you move PowerPoint presentations from one computer to another, it can be a problem. While I'm thinking of it, be very careful about using unusual fonts, because if the computer you're going to doesn't have that font native, I've had the experience where the person brings a presentation to the classroom and we put it up and the language is in Greek or in Russian or whatever it is, because the native font wasn't in that computer. So be very careful about if you're moving computers around or your presentations between computers, that you use native fonts.
Now, here's a point, though, to make. This I first became aware of with corporate clients, that somebody else built their PowerPoints for them. And then different managers will switch slides. And that is random acts of capitalization. So whether you create your PowerPoint or you have someone create them for you, or you're part of a company that uses presentations that other people create. For example, isn't this right, Jim? The normal philosophy is a headline can have capital letters where appropriate. However, when it comes to the bullet points, you need it written more as a sentence.
Yes.
And need to stay consistent, because it's a real disconnect if you have three slides one way and then suddenly the bullet points are all capitalized and then it's back to regular sentences. There's a disconnect and it makes you look less professional.
And a lot of times too, and that's probably true for our audience as well, is when you've been in a presentation and you see a word misspelled on a slide or something wrong with it, don't you think, gosh, I wonder if they know that. Maybe I should raise my hand and tell them that they misspelled the instead of T-H-E, it's T-E-H. So, and when we get into the comparison slides towards the end, I know that I'm nitpicky, but it just shows to you what people pick up on a slide, and we'll step through that. Okay. If you would advance the slide, please.
I'm sorry, I was trying to unmute myself. There were a few questions about the visuals.
Okay.
I wanted to answer those real quick. Alicia said, where do we find the best visuals?
I'll answer that question now. When you're talking about visuals, we subscribe to iStock Photo. We buy a lot of photos through iStock. You can get a lot off of the Google, but the one thing I caution you on is when you take a picture off of Google, make sure that it doesn't, that whoever has it, it doesn't say iShutter.com or iStockPhoto.com, because then you're violating copyright laws. And if you're presenting like Patricia does, we do nothing. Any of the music we use, any videos, any pictures, they're all legal. We buy them or we have access to them legally. So that's my only caution. But later on, I'm going to talk about using pictures, which we were talking about before today's program, about the difference between a PNG and a JPEG. But we'll talk about that in a little bit.
And then we're going to cover this in the presentation as well, but just to let you know, Bill said that his biggest challenge with visuals is designing compelling slides. And then Arthur Retta says that her biggest challenge with visuals is making them interesting and engaging.
Well, let me just discuss that for a second. I hate to admit this, but it's true. There are many times I run out of creativity on the slides, and I go to slideshare.com just to get ideas. And there's another great resource that's in the resource that Patricia is sending out to you called Indesign. And they have a lot of free templates, and he's really brilliant. But just get ideas from other presentations and put them into yours. That's my recommendation for making them more captivating. And we'll talk more about this when we get into using photo, video, and animations and transitions, because those help as well. Okay, so I know that all of us like M&Ms, and we like the kind on the left side. But in PowerPoint, we do want everything to be consistent. And that's why we go to the right side and we use all the same colors for whatever we're doing. There needs to be a tie-in for that. And as you're going to see when I compare the slides towards the end, the difference between consistency and inconsistency. So when you're done with your presentation, and hopefully you can go back to it another day after you're done with it and work with it at that point. Because I think if you do it in the same day, it's very difficult to proofread it. So one of the issues is, and I think this is a great quote, simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. How many of us have seen slides? Patricia and I see this a lot with our clients. We have one client, but they believe they should put everything they know on one slide. And that is totally opposite. And in fact, one of the things that we would say is, the next slide, please. Here, these 1,000 words are worth a single picture. And that's why we use a lot of pictures. And I think almost most of our slides have pictures. And I think the slides that we recommend some changes on also have a lot of pictures on them. Okay. Go ahead. Okay, good. On this slide here, what I wanted to share with you is there's a difference between a projected image that we have today and when you're doing it on a, what we say, a flat screen. If you take a look at the left slide, that's a 4:3 aspect ratio, and that's pretty much square, and you can see the property on it, the area that we have. If you're projecting onto a flat screen, that's a 16:9 aspect ratio, and it may look like there's more real estate, but there's not. You try doing this, it flattens how much text you can put in there and pictures. It looks like there's more, but trust me, when you try to work with it, it's a challenge to get what you want on it. So just be aware of that. If you're a presenter, I suggest to our clients that you ask the facility what type of projection they're going to supply for your presentation, because this will affect your design. While I'm on this, it's okay if you have a 4:3 that goes to a 16:9, because if you do that, the frame itself in this, on the TV screen will be square like the 4:3. But if you go 16:9 onto a 4:3, you've got some problems, and some of you may have done that. Before I forget why we're on this, here's this really cool trick. If you're going to do a 16:9 slide, what I do is just, if you copy paste from the 4:3 into the 16:9, you have to copy it and paste it. You can't insert the slide from, because then it won't change the aspect ratio. But if you click the picture in the 4:3 and paste it in 16:9, PowerPoint automatically puts it in the right aspect ratio. So the inserting doesn't work too well. Okay, this is a slide. These next two slides talk about consistency. This is like a very nice slide. And then if we take a look at a companion slide to this, if we can advance, you can see that it loses everything. It doesn't. This is an inconsistent element, and I see this a lot, and I made this very dramatic to show you the difference here, but this is what I would say talk about when I talk about inconsistency. The next element that I want to talk about is alignment, and I see this a lot, and these are very easy remedies for misalignment. And then on the next slide, you'll see what I'm talking about. On the very top there, you see that there's looks like double space, which there is, on that bullet. On this bullet, you see it's single space, and you can achieve that by put that little shift return. This is from a Mac. If you hit at the AMET on the line right above that, and hit shift click, yes, right there, it'll automatically make that single space for you. And then the last piece of alignment is this piece right here. As you can see, the bullet isn't aligned where the second line is indented. You don't need to do that. And in one more click, and this is, I know it gets technical, but if you don't have your ruler and guides, I strongly recommend that you go to the view pull down menu, turn on rulers, and unclick your guides, because it locks the way they work together. I prefer to have it that way. But all of this is controlled at the top of your frame, and there's no way to show that in a screenshot, so I wasn't able to do that. But that's how you would get your ruler and guides, which are very helpful in designing slides.
I used to have it. Mine seems to have disappeared. How do I get that?
You go to view, click on ruler, and click on guides. They're pulled on the pull-down menu, and that'll work that way.
You mean I tell Harold to go to rulers?
Well, actually, this one's pretty easy. Just pull down menu, view, ruler, and guides. It's pretty easy.
Okay, fine.
Good. So if there's any questions about consistency that we've talked about or alignment, I'm happy to answer them either now or after the session's over. Feel free to email me. I'm happy to address the issues. So let's take a look at the next slide. What is wrong with this slide? Many elements. First of all, the picture is fighting with the text. The second bullet is a different font, and the spacing between the paragraphs is different. So this is what I'm talking about, consistency. It's for my eye, it seems very normal to see these inconsistencies, but I strongly urge you to take a look at that, because people will notice that.
It's a very exaggerated slide. However, we see it all the time. That's the point. Not this dramatic, but it does happen.
Well, thank you for pointing that out. I did make this dramatic to really embellish the inconsistencies here.
And I didn't want you to have anyone think I sent that to Jim to clean up. I do know a little better.
Bad slides I made up, trust me. Mm. Okay. So let's talk about color.
Okay.
Color is a very important element in PowerPoint. And if we can go to the next slide. I want to talk about the color wheel that was developed by Sir Isaac Newton in 1547, I believe it was, which is hard for me to believe when I found that out. But what I wanted to talk about, if you can click, Paul, one click, there we go, and one more. So the red, we're going to say this, if the blue is your primary color, red would be your corollary color, and I'll show you how to do this. So this is the color wheel, and when you pick, I usually pick an outside color, like the pinks or the I don't use green and yellow or orange, and I don't use red, but or violet. I ought to use purple for Fripp. Then you can see that I can use yellow with Fripps and green or orange. Those are complementary colors to the main color. But if we go to the next slide, here's a really cool tool. This is free, and I couldn't demonstrate this to you on the presentation, but if you see those little rings on the outer part of the round wheel, when you actually on the website, if you move those rings, yes, those will show you the colors you can use, and they also show them down here. And at the very bottom left-hand corner of the slide, you see there's a hex number and RGB. Those are the actual numbers that you can put into your color scheme in your computer. It's very cool. And I think the next slide.
Okay, let me be really clear what you're telling us. So what this is telling us, if you have a main color and other colors, it's what looks good together when it's projected as well as when you look. Because we all know, we've seen presentations look great on your computer, but when it's projected, it looks strange.
Yes, well, even you and I have seen that, Patricia, where when I come to your office and I see it, I say, well, that's not the color I meant to use. So that has to do with coordination between the computers. And yeah, so it does pay to take a look at that ahead of time. I think the main point for me on the color wheel was looking for complementary colors. That was what I wanted to show here. Is this is a very easy way. In fact, on one of the slides in the before and after towards the end, I went and got the color wheel and took a look to see what colors I could use to make the complementary.
Okay, perfect.
Good. And next slide, if you see the little ring on the bottom left-hand part of this slide, that eyedropper, when you click on that, wherever you click that and let it go, if you whatever color you leave it on, it will store that color, and then it puts it in the square box next to the eyedropper, and that's the color that you can use, so it's exact, so you can match colors on your existing slides. I think that's a very helpful tool. You can get this in the Mac under Utilities, and then it's Color Picker, and then in Windows, actually I think in PowerPoint now, they have it already in the PowerPoint application. Well, while I'm on this, some of you may be using PowerPoint 2010, 2011, 2013, or 2016. Be very cautious. There's a lot of differences between the different programs. And I've been working with 2016. I still use my 2013. But 2016 has a lot of cool features, but there's also some complications in doing working with it. Okay. And this is the RGB that I was talking about before. Each color has a number, red, green, and blue, and you'll get that from the eyedropper as well. So it's just to show you that the digital color meter is available, and you can get exact colors to match what you're using if you so desire. Okay, what's wrong with this slide? Most of you are probably thinking like I am, the colors don't go together. But there's something else on this slide that most people don't pick up on, and that is that the motorcycle is facing to the outside of the slide instead of inside to the slide. And the very easy way to do this is just rotate it. The only reason why you couldn't rotate it and it won't work is if there's any type on it, because if you rotate the type, it'll be backwards when you rotate it. But the motorcycle should be facing in. The color combination, yellow and green, not good to use in PowerPoint. I don't use a lot of green other than as a complementary color. Most backgrounds are either black, white, like Fripp is white, and then we use some design for that, or a dark, dark color. That's the way to go. But definitely no yellow. I've seen some green, but most of the time it doesn't work that well.
And is it true then, Jim, if it was a face of someone, you've got to be looking into the slide rather than out?
That's right. And all you have to do, and I do this with you, Fripp, on yours, if we want to move you to the left-hand side and you're facing it, just to rotate it. It's very easy to do. That's easy. Okay, next. Okay, so
oh,
this...
talking about me.
Oh, my God. Your favorite subject.
Yeah.
We haven't used this picture before, Fripp, but this is I believe, when it was, you were presenting at the, what organization was this?
Million Dollar Round Table,
which we do have other photos. But yeah. I wanted to show you, demonstrate, I wanted you to learn, see what you can do with, this is going to be the same thing. So, Paul, if you will click once, I bring it down into the square. It's the exact same square, so I just cropped it down to this. And then if you click it one more time, you'll see that I put a frame around it with some fuzz on it. And that's all done through format picture. It's very easy to do. But the long slide, I don't know where we'd ever use it. It's just, it seems odd to me, but I wanted...
Well, that's on my website.
Oh, it is?
Because
oh, okay.
What it is, it's the live shot, because that's a little me. Now, you can see behind my head, it's a little me on the lectern or in front of the lectern speaking to the audience, and then that headshot is superimposed on top.
Good. Okay, good.
It's my website.
I learn something every day.
What did you say, Paul?
Oh, I said it's the website header.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
And I think we use this on Facebook and Twitter as the header image.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next. So this is a really cool tool. Here's Darren McCroy and Patricia Fripp. And if you will move to the next slide, here's a really cool tool. You see the picture of Fripp and Darren on the left-hand side? Mm. this website will give you the colors that you can use in your presentation if you're using them as a focal point of a slide. So this is another cool tool. And it's although everything I'm showing you so far is free. The only thing that's not free is iStockPhoto. And their prices have gone up.
I noticed a $220 charge on our last credit card.
Well, it's not the $220 so much as how much they're now charging for each photo. And yeah. By the way, they're charging one flat rate no matter what size you get. So get the largest because you can compress it. But if you get the smallest, you can't enlarge it. And I'll talk about that in a slide that's coming up.
Well, all the more reason for using photographs of yourself or different scenes.
Yeah, there you go. So if anybody has questions about color, if you'll send them to Paul. Paul, do we have any questions on any of the elements so far?
Not so many questions, but Claudette and Arthretta made a comment about the what's wrong with the slide, with the Chilean slide, and they were correct. It was too much going on and too much text. And then Mike Wachschel said that if you were using some screenshots, that there's an application called Snagit where you can capture the entire screen.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Snagit. Since I use the Mac, I do a full screenshot or just a smaller part. I haven't used Snagit, though, but I'm going to take a look into that. I'm assuming it's better than just the regular screenshot from the Mac. Okay. So next, we're going to talk about photos.
Okay.
And I'd like to focus in on the ring, the red ring at the bottom, sort of left-hand part of the screen, where you see that little number. When you go to Google, you'll see those numbers, 500 by 500. My caution you on this, you want to get into the thousands if you're going to be using your pictures or expanding them, because 500 by 500 you only can use in its native size because it'll pixelate very quickly. So when you're looking for photos, make sure that you look for photos that have a high resolution. And if we can go to the next slide, you'll see here is a perfect example of that. This is 1920 by 1279. So it's going to be a heavy in terms of size, but you'll be able to expand this on any slide. It's much easier to do. The only time I'd use a really small one is if I'm going to keep it small. So I'd like to see the next slide here for a second. So this, I wanted to demonstrate a cool issue. Paul, if you can go back to show, I want them to see that the blue, you're clicking so that the blue appears there. And this is to demonstrate what a JPEG looks like. So if we click again, so this, you see the white around the challenge, and that is a JPEG. I was so frustrated about this a couple years ago. I would go into Photoshop and get rid of the white and then try to move it, and the white always came back, and I finally found out why. You really need to have a Photoshop PNG file. And if you click one more time, you'll see that fabric, if you will, that those gray checks. That tells you it's a pink slide, and there will be no white there. There'll be no background. It'll be transparent. And this is cool. In Google, when you want a picture, you can type the name of the picture and then .png, and it will return Photoshop pictures. Not all of them are, but there are quite a few that are PNG. And this is where you, like for this program on the left-hand side had a blue background, that white really stands out. There is one other trick that I used in doing this. I went to, on the challenge, I clicked on it, and then I said in picture format, remove background color. So within PowerPoint, you can remove the background color. It's not that easy. One technique I've learned is make the slide as big as you can and make it easier to get that done. This challenge slide was easy. It was just one click and it went away. But if you have any questions on that, let me know. Okay, so this doesn't look so bad, I guess, on your computer. They're a little bit fuzzy. This was a slow resolution slide. And if we go to the next one. So this is a photo that I just would like you to see how this works. This is a high resolution photo. And if we click one more time, you can see I'm going to expand it to the entire slide, and it maintains its clarity. It doesn't pixelate.
Yes. Wow.
So this you can see. One other thing while I'm on this, because you're not going to see any on the slides. When you get a picture like this, make sure there is no watermark on it. I think that reflects poorly on us as presenters if we're using watermarks on our picture.
Because the watermark shows what?
Shows who owns the photo.
Exactly.
Exactly. So we, yeah. A lot of times now they're getting very tricky on how they put their watermark in there. So I look very closely. But again, for all of our paying clients, we only use legal material. Just so you know, because I teach in a class, and universities are pretty careful, but we're not going to get hurt. I don't use them, but I could use.
And though this is true, I spoke for several corporations that they needed us to prove where we had paid for all our photographs.
That's
so
right.
A couple, one of Michael Caine, we'd taken from the internet, so we couldn't prove that we paid for it, so we took it out.
Yep.
So, many of our clients, as Dan Maddox says, I have 5 lawyers on staff making sure that everything that is used in our documents and in our, live is totally legal. And this is a quote I heard at, I believe it was NSA, and very simply, somebody owns everything. And if you're using it, you have to pay them. That's it.
But I also think, Patricia, it doesn't reflect well on professional speakers that they would do something like that. I just think that's not good for your art, for your image. That's my view. So we get into video. I don't want to get into the technical part of this. Most of you probably know you can go to YouTube and there's downloaders. I use Firefox or Google, depending on what I'm downloading. But I thought it would be interesting for you to see how to download this. If you will click once, Paul. And this is the download button. This is on Firefox. And it shows you 2 file sizes. I always go for the largest I can get because, again, those are going to pixelate when you try to expand them. And there we go. So let's, for a second, talk about linked and then embedded. A linked file with a video, the video stays where it is, and you're telling PowerPoint, go get that video and show it. And it's very, very fast. There's not a delay at all. Embedding it means your video is in the PowerPoint. When you play that slide, it's there. The big difference is embedded videos make the file bigger. But the problem with linked files, if those files are not in the same folder as your PowerPoint, you'll break the link. So what I recommend, if you're going to link, put everything in one folder, we'll just say Fripp webinar, and put the PowerPoint in there, all the elements that you want to link, video, audio, what have you, and link them from that folder, and then save that PowerPoint in that folder, and then you can move the folder to any computer and everything will stay linked. So if you've ever been to a presentation and they have the video and it doesn't show, it's probably because the link is broken. Go ahead, Patricia.
This is because often now, clients say, well, send us your PowerPoint. But a lot of my slides have Fripp VT. Some of the clips are embedded in them. Some of them need to be in the same folder. So I do my best whenever possible is to control it myself. Sometimes you can't. So very often I say, well, I'm going to send you the videos. Make sure they're all in a folder. And then pray and do a rehearsal.
Okay. Now, while we're on this, I don't recommend linking a PowerPoint to an outside source on the internet. Big issue is, what if the Wi-Fi doesn't work?
Yeah.
And I just see so many times there's a problem with that. Most videos you can download from YouTube, and there are ways around the other videos. Camtasia is one. QuickTime will not record the sound without you need another add-on to do that. So downloading seems to be the easiest if it has the download button. And most videos I see on YouTube have those today.
All right. And there are a couple of questions from Bob and Claudette. Paul, would you like to read them?
Yes. There were 2 questions about photos and videos. Bob asked, where's somewhere that you can buy photos at a good price?
Oh, what a great question. Hey, Bob, what if I gave you a link to a website that you can get free photos? I will get that link and we'll send it out to the on another memo to the Fripp VT. So make a note of that, free videos. I will also list...
Paul can write, if you give it to us, Paul will put it in the chat box so everyone can see.
I don't have it right in front of me. I'll get it to him.
Now, this is a question then. If we can get great photos free, why am I paying so much for iStock Photo? Answer that, Prost.
I will answer. Thank you for asking that. We pay for iStock Photo because I can get much more focused on what I'm looking for. So I will spend quite a bit of time going through the page and pages and pages of pictures on iStock Photo and then to get the right one. I don't know how long I can go on looking on Google.
Okay, so this is a point. Do you learn to do the PowerPoint yourself, or do you learn the basics and get someone like Prost to put the magic in and make the handouts or whatever? It depends. There are different times in your life that you have more time than money, and there are other times you have more money than time. So when you have more money than time, or you think, I can spend an hour talking to a coaching client and make this much, I can pay somebody else to make my PowerPoint or proof my articles or do my bookkeeping or whatever it is you're delegating for the same or less time than it would take you. So it's a matter of managing your resources as far as money and as far as time. So, of course, if you're hiring someone like Prost, which I am, do I pay him to save time and then it means you're going to pay more for the photos? So it all works out. But so if you want to find free photos because you got plenty of time, use that. Yeah. If you need a resource where you have limited time and you can go directly to images specifically that you want, then you're better to pay for it.
And I also include a website. We don't use clip art. I'll talk about that later on.
Okay. Well, I know we have some before and afters. Yeah. So let's... okay. Let's, and Mike is saying Adobe Stock charges $1 per picture, $10 minimum per month.
Oh, good deal. I didn't know that. Okay.
Good. Okay. And one quick question. We learn from each other, part of being a community.
That's good.
A quick question from Claudette concerning the videos or image.
Yes.
If you have something linked within the PowerPoint presentation, does it have to be in the exact same folder as the PowerPoint file, or can it be in a subfolder within that folder?
If everything is on the same computer, if you link from a folder to your PowerPoint and you have it on the same computer and you haven't moved it, that link will stay. But I recommend embedding them, but the link will stay as long as wherever the item is and the PowerPoint, they need to be connected. If you move either one of them out of the location, like from the desktop to a folder, from the folder to the desktop, you do that, the link is broken. So think of it like a telephone line between the picture and the slide or the file. So if you break that link, it doesn't know where to go for it. And it'll just say that you can't find, you want to look for it.
So if you have a folder that the PowerPoint presentation is in, let's say the folder's name is Jim.
Yeah.
Within that folder, you have an images folder or videos folder.
Yeah.
And you link it from that videos folder in that presentation folder. Will that work just to transfer that whole main folder?
Yeah. As long as everything is connected within the same house, if you will.
Perfect.
Okay. So this part I named it Showtime, and it's partly being in front of the audience, but this is also getting into beyond the design. It's getting into the animation and transitions. So this is an example of an animation GIF file. And there's others too that people don't think about using. This is a path. I just used an eyeball and used a path for it. And if we click one more time, you can see it go the other way. This is a really cool animation tool that you can use. It's in the animation screen. So I highly recommend you consider using it as long as you don't overdo it and make it too artsy, if you will. Excuse me. Okay, next slide. This is inconsistency. This is inconsistency that would drive an audience nuts.
Yes.
I very rarely use fly-in. Most everything on Fripp's presentation. Do you hear that?
Oh, yes. And you know what I found? It's somebody at a conference, it wasn't a professional speaker, but they had this, and people, we were waiting for the sound. We couldn't pay attention to what the speaker was saying. You know, the first time it was cute, but then it kept coming, and when's it coming again?
Yeah. I left that in there because I had some students at Berkeley where every letter that came out, it had the typewriter sound. That's why I included that. Very simple. I mean, it depends on the organization. If you're a very creative organization, I can understand using some really cute, but if you're dealing with businesses, I err on the side of simplistic. So I mostly have them appear, and we also will have them turn gray, which we'll get into in a second. And next slide. Transition, I just want to mention, animation is what happens on the slide. Transition, if you will click, Paul, is what happens between slides. So if we click here, slide 13 becomes slide 14. And so what happens in between that? There's a really cool new tool that just came out, and PowerPoint, well, if you have 2016, it will automatically load that in for you, called Zoom. And we may see that in some of the slides if it works on this computer. Next. Okay, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but just to say, we would never show this slide the way it is, but you still can use it. And Paul, if you would just click through so that they can see how you can use this slide and build each element. So here we have the technology and people, and then we have the technology elements, and then the people elements, and then we put them together, and then we show how this works for this company's, what they're selling. So shows you can have complex slides, but if you build it and tell the stories you're building it, the audience can follow. If you show a picture like that all at one time, most audiences, the brain can't handle it, and they just disconnect for that.
And this was an actual slide from one of our corporate clients that Jim took apart. So that was, it ended up the same, but it would make more sense for the listening audience.
Yeah. So this part is, as you can see from this pull-down menu, in the slideshow you can use presenter view. This gives you, on the left-hand side of your screen, I think, Paul, if you go to the next slide, I have an image of it. The left-hand is the image that's showing on the screen. The image on the right is the slide that's coming up. And the slides on the bottom are the slides in sequence. So this is a really cool way to see, get a bigger picture. And you also can put your notes below there if you want. So if you need your notes, they'll be below that. But a lot of times people don't know about presenter view. Okay, this is a cool element. If you push the B key when you're presenting, the screen will go black. And if you push that one more time, Paul, it'll go to the black screen. And then, go back one more. And I go forward to the white, that's the black, and then white. If you hit this W, hit it, and it'll go white, and hit it one more time, and it goes back to your slide. This is a great way to keep your audience's attention on you and not on the slide. Next. Paul, let's demonstrate this for them. You can navigate your presentations through by pushing the number of the slide you want to go to. So you're on slide number 61. If you will hit 6-2, or actually let's not do that, let's hit 6-3 and show them what happens when you do that. So using this tool will automatically move you to the number that you put into your keyboard. You need to be near the keyboard, but it's a very cool way to get to a presentation if you have too many slides and you know where you want to go.
And just make sure you hit enter after you type of the number.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Let's get into the comparison. So two VT participants sent a slide. And if we can advance this. So this is the slide that a person sent to me. I've X'd out their names and their confidential information, but this was their slide number one. And then, Paul, if you just advance it. So they had the name of the speech in the footer for all the slides. I would recommend having your copyright in the slide number, not much else usually in there. It's a distraction. You don't want people's attention brought onto that. And then if you advance it again, this is the redo on that. Again, I changed the name. You could put an image on here if you wanted as well, whether it's your picture or some other element. But it was simple looking. I thought we'd keep it that way. This is the slide that was submitted. And on the left-hand side, you see the bullets, which is a screenshot. Sometimes we have to do that, but if you can, it looks nice to have the fresh, you know, type it fresh. And if you push the next slide, and then you'll see that we've changed that. And here's the new look. So we're also animating this by just the view. And then we have the element come in. So we're leading the audience. What you want to do is lead your audience through your story visually. And then we just have the copyright and the page number on this one. Okay, next one. You can just click through on this, Paul. They can see, I put alignment, I framed the slide, the pictures, and put color into the text box. In animated, I had them come out, each one of them came out one at a time. Again, leading your audience through your story, think about the story. And this slide here, not much, I just put some frames around it, as you can see. On this slide here, this one is also a screenshot. It looks like that anyhow, and it's pretty, as you can see, pixelated, but that's what we had to work with. And again, I didn't show the next slide. It wasn't a big deal on this. I keep clicking. Okay. Okay, in advance again. And there I just aligned the elements. And then this is the last slide. I put a little back up one, Paul. This is a great information of random capitalization. On the headlines, very rarely do I use all capitals. I use uppercase for the first letter of a word appropriately, but not where I would use the lowercase to the rest of it. And then if you click one more time, you can see a little ad effect on that. Paul, if you go to slide 79 and 80, which I think are the next two, on this slide here, it didn't change anything, but I wanted you to see something. The next slide. This slide here, you barely can see it, but the text that was white on the previous slide is black on this slide, and that's a black and white view of the slide, or grayscale. And if you're interested, if you have 2010, 2011, or 2013, I can give you an add-on that will fix this. I haven't gotten the answer from PowerPoint for 2016 on how to fix that, because it's going to print out black. But as soon as I do, we'll send that out to you as well.
Okay, so you mean, because I know we do this with mine, you have a beautiful colored image, and that was very attractive. But if you turn it into a handout in black and white, is that when
the problem. I go through the presentation before I send the slides in black and white to make, and I look at them in black and white or grayscale to make sure that there's no black. Even I did it on this presentation as well to make sure. But I wanted people to see this because you can run into that. What's really weird is it's white on the slide and you'd think it'd print white, but it doesn't. Yeah. Paul, we can advance pretty quickly through these next couple. This particular one, on this one I wanted to mention that whoever designed this, notice they have the consistent font. The only thing I changed was I animated it. And
what you say about the slide number?
There was no slide numbers on here. Thank you for asking, Patricia. We add slide numbers on our presentations for content slides. Someone in the audience could say to you, oh, Patricia, back on slide 53, you mentioned this. Well, all she has to do is put 53 in enter, and it'll take her to that slide. So that's an easy piece to do. On this one here, I know I'm picky, but notice that there's a period after the third bullet and not on the first and the fourth. So again, take a look at those. Take a look at them. Go ahead. The only thing I want to mention is this is 16-point font on the second bullet, and on the next slide, which I redid, is I made it the same size, so it's 24 and 24. So keep the fonts the same. Don't just change because you have more lines. Do not add more lines just because make the text smaller. Add more slides. Here's a little point. Slides are free. They don't cost anything. Use as many as you need.
And in fact, we often, I know I say to my clients, yeah, don't be afraid of using more slides and have less content on them if you need it. Because isn't it true, Jim, the more content you have, the people can't read and listen to you at the same time.
Right, exactly. And that's why I introduced the B and the W key to blank out the screen. We can move ahead. On this slide here, there's 10 bullets. That's way too many to put up on a slide. And if you go to the next two slides, Paul, you'll see that I've broken this into 5 and 5 and gave them some more. This is much easier to pay attention to. And yeah, and the next slide.
I have to avoid buffets. I love buffets. Which is why you avoid buffets. They always include desserts.
And this one here, I just put an angle on it, formatted the picture to make it a little more interesting. And this slide here, click on it, Paul, to show them what I did. I added some animation to make, so brought in one part and then the verses part. So one, the left-hand side came in first and then the right-hand side. So just people's, you're leading them to your story again, okay?
Oh, and what about the centered? So are they all centered, Jim, or just some of them are centered?
The headline? Some of the originals were not centered, and all the ones that I had done, I centered the text, both vertically and horizontally, so it would be in the middle of the box. Because so when you flip this, when you go through slides like this, the audience sees them. If you have them in different places, they see it jumping. That's part of the reason to put it in the same place.
Okay.
And on this slide here, I just wanted you to see how you remove the notice, the background on this piece of.
Yes.
If you click it one more time, Paul, the background's gone.
Ooh. So
remove background on a slide like that. And I think we have. I just go through on these. I added animation here. I added animation.
Oh, yes, yes. Don't buy it, don't bring it home, and don't give in. That's very clever.
Oh, this is the one here. There's clip art in this. We didn't use clip art for anything else in this presentation. Consistency, if you click once, Paul, I found this slide I thought was really cool for mindless eating, where you see her multitasking and the food all over her place. And then I put some design on it. This number 10, notice the spacing. There was always a space on the previous 9 tips, but on the 10th there wasn't a space. And I know this is picky and I apologize, but consistency. And the last slide, I believe, keep going. I know we're out of time, but keep going. I wanted to go to slide number 104.
Oh, Jim, they will forgive us a few more minutes.
Okay.
Yes, they want content. I love that image.
Well, there's something about this image that strikes me as, this looks to me like an image that has been stretched going from 4:3 to 16:9. I don't know that for a fact, but it looks stretched to me. So I put it back and then put some framework. But when you see a photo like that, you really need, if you can go back one, it looks to me like it's stretched this way. And I wasn't sure where it came from, but I just made it uncompressed. But this does demonstrate what happens when you go from a 4:3 to a 16:9. It stretches the photo, and you'll notice that very clearly.
But who could resist that little face?
I know.
I think he's saying, I'm going to eat what I want to eat.
Good. Well, does anybody have any questions?
All right, so let's... Oh, yes, and you do have, a nice little animation. You just did demonstrate what we will be sending is a resource sheet of where you can get more information. There's Prost, of course, if you need to send him an email or call. And we're going to send the handout of the slides. Jim, you did remove the before and afters of our clients.
Yes.
So, but all the rest of the content is there. Yeah. Let us see. Bob is asking, is Presenter View available on the Mac?
Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Just go to,
I just made you big. Now, as you will notice, I don't know if you can see yourself in the screen.
I can.
This is not a good time to do a webinar in your part of town. Just pick coach bring the blind down, just because we're teaching our own people. So go see if it makes any difference. Now, if you like to go down, Paul, can you make me big?
Yes, and Mark, just so you know, this is actually an example of what presenter view looks like on a Mac. I just want to share my screen there, and I'll turn it back over to Fripp.
Oh, okay. Well, much more important for you to show your screen. Go back to
They thought it was up there for a few seconds.
Oh, okay, good. You see, Harold worked for me. As you know, you're part of our community. You know we deliver webinars all the time. This is our third today for different audiences. And Harold, who is my assistant, is a photographer, and he takes this very seriously, and he was getting most upset because you do webinars at different times in the day. And, of course, I have a window to, well, it's my left. It's, of course, I'm backwards for you, but that is where the window is. And so my face was always a lot lighter on one side. So Harold has actually it's bored. I could take it out if we're not doing any webinars. It's just there's rarely a day that we don't have webinars or Zoom meetings to block out the light at least 90%. And then he has two lights coming forward that are not at the brightest. And everything we do is a lot more work than you actually think. Not that it'll ever be perfect, but we improve it. So let's go back and look at Jim and let's see.
I apologize for that.
That's much better.
I started the day out in fog and all of a sudden the sun came out when we started this.
Yes, so we were missing your handsome face.
Sorry about that.
When it was mostly the PowerPoint, but I wanted them to see you're really quite handsome and you don't have these lines on your face.
I'm glad you were paying attention.
Good. So, Paul, are there any other specific questions we need to address?
No, that's all we have for now.
All right, good. Now, we challenge you all, one, to go into Fripp VT and take advantage of what you've invested in. Look out the two new courses that you can see. The executive overview is very short. It's one chapter. The second one, it has multiple points, but it's in within one file, one chapter on networking techniques. And of course, all the handouts that go with them are in your file vault. You will also, if you go to the file vault, you will see some ebooks. And one of them, and it's not a long book, but it's an ebook, How to Put the Power into Your PowerPoint. And that was written by mostly Jim and some comments by me. And that will help reinforce, all free. This webinar, as with others, will be added to your webinar segment in your Fripp VT. So with that, we really thank you for your support. We thank you for your active participation. We encourage you to participate, even if you can't. I know everyone listening now is live, but those of you who are watching the replay, every invitation you get, don't wait, sign up. And I cannot believe that of all our community, only two people stepped up and said, look at my PowerPoint, because Jim, of course, does give our attendees the redone version. So we show you the before and after, but he actually creates the slides and makes the difference for you to use yourself.
And we should thank them for doing that also, Patricia. It was very kind of them to submit them.
Well, yes, and of course they get your advice and your help for nothing. So please spread the word for Fripp VT. Tell all your friends, one, if they are members, to tune in on a regular basis. If they are not, get everyone to take a trial of Fripp VT. The world will be better when everyone is a powerful, persuasive presenter. So, Jim, do you have a walk-away line on PowerPoint?
Hope you learned how to put the power in your PowerPoint through this hour.
Well, good.
Thank you for spending the afternoon with me.
Good. Well, we appreciate it. And, Paul, thank you as always for your work. And goodbye, everyone. Thank you for your participation. Bye.
Bye.